Now, we've just had the International Clinical Trials Day on the 20th of May, and we thought this was an opportune time for talking about clinical trials. We've all been hearing so much about it in reference to the COVID vaccinations and all. So we thought we'll educate everybody as much as possible with our esteemed doctors here, Dr. Seema Gulia, who's a professor in Tata Memorial Hospital of Medical Oncology. And then we have Priyanka Bhattacharya, who's the head of the clinical operation team of Roche. So welcome to both of you, and thank you for agreeing to be on part of as a part of our educational webinar. Just to give a little background, the first reference of a clinical trial is recorded in a book of Daniel in the Bible. There was a famous king, I don't know how to pronounce his name, who ordered his people to eat and drink only meat and wine, a diet he believed would keep everybody healthy and happy and strong. But there were some vegetarians who refused to listen to what he was saying. So he said, "We'll give vegetarian food for 10 days to one group of people and non-vegetarian to the other, and we will record their health status after the 10 days." So when the recording was done of the status, it was found that the people who ate the diet of beans and water were fitter than those who had eaten non-vegetarian food. So with that, he decided to let people go by his diet and have whatever they want to eat. Otherwise, maybe the situation would be what we had in India some time back, saying you can't eat this and you can't eat that. So thanks for that, I think. One of the first physician trial was conducted in 1747, where Dr. James Lind tested several scurvy treatments on crew members of the British naval ship Salisbury and discovered that lemon and oranges were the most effective in treating the condition. Lind is considered the first physician to have conducted a controlled clinical trial of the modern era. May 20th, so it's called the International Clinical Trial Day because that is the day in 1747 that the trial started. So with this background, I would like to come to Priyanka. And, can we start from the very beginning? Because we've heard a lot about the phases of the trials and, what are the different phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four? What does it mean? Could you please talk about it?
Sure. Thank you, Vandana ji. I'm very happy to be here today. So, in the different phases of a clinical trial actually indicate the stages of development of that medicine. So, for example, in phase one is the first trial that is conducted in healthy volunteers, and it's done in a smaller group of people, and it's mainly to check whether, first of all, what dose should be given of that medicine, and whether that medicine is safe or not. So once phase one is completed, we move on to phase two, in which phase two trial, what is checked is whether the medicine is working or not. So if it's efficacious or not. And once that is conducted in a larger group, say 100 to 300 patients. And this trial is conducted, a phase two trial is conducted in patients who are suffering from the ailment. And then we move on to phase three. And in phase three, we actually compare this medicine with the standard of care. So what is actually available in the market, what is being used for these patients, you compare that treatment with the new medicine that is being investigated in the trial. And then once the phase three data is evaluated and once a positive data is obtained, then the application is made for marketing of that medicine in the country. And after the marketing is done, after the medicine becomes available in the market, then we have phase four trials, which is done called post-marketing studies, where you look at the medicine in the actual setting, the clinical setting, whether it's working or not. So those are the four phases of a clinical trial.
So are you saying that all these trials are done only in one country, or are they done in multiple countries? How do you recruit your people?
No, mostly these trials are conducted in multiple countries, especially from phase two onwards. Phase one may be done in a smaller group, so it may be done in one country, but phase two, phase three is done across the globe, multi-country trials, multi-center trials, as we call them. And then phase four is usually conducted per country. Like, for example, in India, the Indian government asks us to conduct a phase four study in the country.
Okay. So Dr. Gulia, coming to you, how do you, you know, with so many trials going on for different this thing, diseases and different medicines and all that, how do you create an awareness of trials amongst the patients?
Basically, the patients who come to us, and before we decide on the treatment for an individual patient, we have our trial unit running in Tata Hospital. So as per the patient condition, the state of the disease, what type of disease they are having, we discuss with them that this is the treatment option for you. But particularly in your case, there is one trial which is also running. So if you are willing to participate in the trial or not. So this is one-to-one information that we give to our patient who present to Tata Memorial Hospital. But there are definitely different ways in which this information regarding clinical trials can be disseminated amongst the patient. And there are nowadays, because the media has gone virtual and in this COVID time, everybody knows how to look at the different medias, different ways, platforms where they can get information regarding the clinical trials. We have our ICMR sites are available, government sites are available where they can check which trial is running, in what patient group it is applicable.
You're on mute,
Dr. Gulia, you are suggesting that about the trials, the patients are informed right in the beginning of the treatment, or is it like in between the treatment that they are told about it?
So when we plan a treatment for any patient, the inclusion into the any trial, it happens right in the beginning of the treatment plan. We cannot stop one treatment in between and then enroll a patient for a trial. And there are very strict inclusion and exclusion criteria for including a patient into the clinical trial. And if the patient fits into all those inclusion and exclusion criteria, then we discuss with the patient if they are willing to participate in the trial or not.
Oh, thank you for this clarification, because, you know, most of the time people thought that one goes on to a clinical trial only if all other treatments have failed. No, so then you are put on a clinical trial. But I'm glad you brought out this point.
Yeah, that is not the case. Different trials are available for different stage of the disease. Like there are certain trials which are available for in curative intent setting. That means patient has finished one line of treatment. Now they are cancer free. Then there is a trial for that kind of patient. Patient who are presenting to us in the metastatic state. And then if whether they have received one line of treatment or two lines of treatment or three lines of treatment. So depending upon what prior treatment they have taken, then there are different trials set for this. So different trials are available for different stages of disease.
Thank you. Thank you for this clarification. It will be very helpful. So now tell me, Priyanka, that you must be having a team of people who help in designing the clinical trial and who work on the clinical trials. Of course, there would be doctors and scientists and, you know, all the various people. Do you have a patient advocate also on the clinical trial designing?
So actually, if you had asked me this question, say about 5-10 years ago, my answer would have been no. Because usually what a clinical trial is done, it's mostly you're taking into consideration the medical aspects of it and also the scientific aspects. So when should the dose be given? What laboratory assessment should be done and all. But in the last few years, thankfully, this has changed. And we have now, most companies are now actually taking inputs from patient advocacy groups on the design of the clinical trial, because a patient is actually at the center of the trial, because the patient has to come to the center, get the testing done, get everything done. So now many companies are using different means of getting these inputs. Sometimes they send out a questionnaire. Sometimes they call people in for an interview, or they are also conducting roundtable meetings to get inputs into a trial design at the beginning, when the trial is being designed. It's still something that is picking up as a trend, and it's not as popular as one would hope it to be, but it's definitely started and is gradually gaining more momentum.
So the popularity of having a patient advocate is because you think that the patient advocates are not engaged enough, or are not educated enough, or are not giving you the right information, or you haven't still found adequate number of patient advocates to be a part of the trial.
It could be a mix of things. Usually, I mean, in our case, we've seen a patient advocacy group that we've approached. It's never the case that they're not educated enough or not aware of the condition. So we have seen in our experience is actually the patient advocacy group forms a very good bridge between the patients and the pharma companies. So what could be a hurdle in getting across is that you don't know the right groups to approach. Or, you know, how should we approach? Because sometimes it's just a phone number or sometimes it's just a group. Then you just reach out to the website. So the pharma companies need to connect with the right groups and in the right manner. If that is the case, the information that we get is usually very authentic and validated from the other side.
So it's actually a learning for the NGOs also that they should be able to connect or pass on information if contacted that, you know, there's somebody who can help you out and not restricted to saying we don't do it and we are not aware. So I think it's a collaboration even amongst the NGOs, which will be helpful.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
So Dr. Gulia, once the trial is there, once you have identified the process, the patient, what is the process of enrollment of the patient in the trial?
So right from the beginning, first we identify the patient, whether this patient is fitting into any of the trials which are running at the site at present. The different trials are available, as I told you in the beginning, depending upon the state of the disease as well as the patient condition. So once we identify the patient and appropriate clinical trial in which patient can fit in, we explain this process to the patient that for your disease, this is the treatment option available. But there is also a trial which is ongoing at this site, if you are willing to participate in the trial. So participation in a trial is voluntary, right? Even if patient is willing to participate, then only they will participate in the trial. So before we begin the whole process, the first step comes is the informed consent. Informed consent, actually the whole process wherein we start educating the patient about the clinical trial, that this is the trial, in this trial, this medicine is being tested. What would be the possible aim of the trial, what we are trying to look at by doing this study, and in this study how many centers are involved, whether it is limited to one center or it is limited to one country or multiple countries are involved, what would be the approximate number of patients that would participate, what could be the possible side effects of the new drug which we are testing, and what precautions or measures will be taken to protect the safety of the patient. And in between, we keep on reinforcing to them that your participation in the trial is voluntarily. If they do not want to participate in the trial, then there is this treatment, which is standard of care, which is available. And even if you do not participate in the trial, that will not hamper your treatment in any way. And your doctor-patient relationship will be maintained. And after explaining it to them, then enough time is given to them so that they can decide whether they want to participate or not. They can discuss with their family members and they can come back next day. And if they have any queries, we try to solve them.
So between the time that you start enrolling a patient and giving the explanation to the time that he actually begins and comes on the trial, how much time is normally spent in that?
So just to explain them and they will come back to us, it takes 1 to 2 days for them to take the decision whether they want to participate in the trial. Then the whole process will begin. If they are willing to participate in the trial, then they will sign that informed consent. Then as per the requirement of the trial, they have to undergo certain tests to ascertain whether they are fit to enroll into the trial, whether they are satisfying all the inclusion criteria. Here it means like certain trials, they require centralized lab testing for the tumor tissue per se. So that might take another 2 to 3 weeks to confirm whether the tumor is actually fitting into the clinical trial. And then certain imaging needs to be done as per the trial requirement, like CT scan or a bone scan, that will be done. And then they will be enrolled into the trial. And at the same time, because most of the trials are in phase 3, which we are doing. And then we explain to the patient also at the time of taking informed consent that you have an equal chance of coming into either of the group with medicine and the group without the medicine which is being tested.
So we'll go on to that later, Dr. Gudia. But since you're talking about the informed consent, Priyanka, on behalf of the pharma companies, can you tell us I've seen the informed consents and the complexity of informed consents and, you know, the language that is used in the informed consent. Is there a particular reason that the pharma company designs the informed consent in that way to make it as difficult as possible for the patient to understand?
No. Actually, in fact, the intent of the informed consent form is to provide all the information in the simplest of terms, but we are bound by certain rules. So like the good clinical practice, GCP rules are there. And then there are also rules of the Indian government that need to be followed. So considering all that, actually what happens is there are many aspects of the trial that information has to be shared. Like Dr. Gulia mentioned, we need to explain why the trial is being conducted, what are the risk factors, what are the whether you can participate or not. So adding all those information makes it one a little bit of a long document, more than what we would want it to be. And the intent is to bring it down to common language as much as possible. But sometimes some things are very difficult to explain, like the disease area and all. So honestly speaking, the intent is not to complicate matter. The intent is to bring it as much information as possible to the patient to be able to make an informed decision on it. So because of the rules and regulations, it tends to be a long document with a lot of information, which may confuse the patient, but these are required because this information has to go out.
You know what I feel, that most of these documents are made abroad, maybe in America, designed somewhere else, where the language is extremely different from the language that we speak in India. So even a simple thing becomes very complicated. I mean, I've seen this in various forms, you know, that the thing becomes very complicated. But considering that it is going to be given to a population which may or may not be so educated, may not be able to read, especially English, or, you know, the translations also are extremely complicated. So I really think that, something should be done about it, because very often patients really don't understand what it is, what is being served, and the doctors and the people who are conducting their trial are really at a loss, because they have to go by what has been given by the pharma company.
True.
So as a part of a patient community, may I request if something can be done about it in the future?
Yes.
It would be really helpful, because, you know, I always feel that a patient informed consent should be understood by a class 4 student. And if a class 4 student can understand, that means it is more or less understandable, and, you know, everybody can understand it. So on behalf of the patients, Dr. Gulia, do you agree with me, or am I?
I would like to point out that one thing, that class to be able to understand the informed consent by class 4 student would be a little difficult. But at least if a class 8 student can understand, that would be enough, because this is what our hospital ethics committee also lays very important discussion on this informed consent, that at least a class 8 student should be able to understand.
Yeah, so to make it simpler.
Simpler as possible.
Yeah, so can you not have like a lay summary of the whole informed consent in short, like a summary, so that I as a patient can read that summary and understand that this is going to happen to me. I may not understand the complete sense of it, but at least the basic thing I would understand. And then maybe a video to show what will happen, because, you know, verbally I may not understand, I may not be in a position to ask questions, but if I see a video, maybe I can understand even more. And so that will all add up to the ease from the patient's point of view. So are these permitted, the lay summaries and the videos and all, are they permitted to be used?
Yes. So actually some of the trials that we are also working on, we have started adding these materials. So these are, in our terminology, we call it patient facing material. So in order to use this material, one thing that has to be done is we need to submit it proactively to the ethics committee. And they will then review and approve it. If they've approved it, then we can use it. And as we are gradually moving, especially with the COVID situation, we are trying to bring in e-consenting, which is an electronic means through a tab, you know, you connect and remotely get the consent. So in that, we have started, we are looking, exploring ideas to add videos and so that the patient can look at it at their leisurely time and understand it and then be able to take a decision. So these are definitely solutions which can look at. And also now many companies are coming up with websites which are for patients to look, explore clinical trials. So that is also there, like US government has it, clinicaltrial.gov has layman summaries of the results of the trial. But there can be solutions in the form of websites and other means of, you know, explaining in simpler terms what the trial is about. Definitely. And a point noted, I will take it back to everyone.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
I would also like to add that layman summary has started in many of the trials in last 1 or 2 years, which was not there. So it is picking up and yes, hopefully it will pick up more.
So just to add, you know, Dr. Gulia, I had gone to Australia about 7-8 years back, and I was on the process of learning things like clinical trials was something that I was working on, and that time they had lay summaries in Australia. So when I came back and I, you know, showed the samples to Tata Memorial Hospital, but probably it was not accepted at that time because ICMR guidelines did not approve of lay summaries. So I'm glad that, you know, now it's picking up and it's going to
In Tata Hospital it has started. We have to give lay summary.
Really nice. So Dr. Gulia, when you have all these challenges of, you know, explaining things to the patients, talking to the patients, have you thought of having patient advocates as a part of the clinical trial group?
Yeah, definitely. Like, yeah, because
thing and then to explain to the patients. And, you know, very often the patients are a little scared to question the doctors because they feel that that's obvious, you know, problem that the doctor may get offended or something like that. So have you thought about that? Is that allowed by the government?
I mean, it's a very good idea. And I do face challenges in explaining to the patient regarding the trial. And it's not easy for them to understand because the whole conducting clinical trial is a complex issue. Right. So right from understanding what is a trial, what are their rights as a patient, what risks are involved. So there are many questions which are there in patients' mind. Some do ask, some they don't ask. But by looking at their facial expression, we can make out that they are facing difficulty in understanding and definitely making a choice for them, what is right, what is not right. So patient advocacy will definitely help them to understand the whole process so that they are more well informed in taking their decision, what decision they are taking.
So for that also, you have to go back to the pharma company whose trial is being conducted or to the ICMR or you can take a decision on your own.
Regarding patient advocacy?
Yeah.
So I'm not sure whom I have to approach regarding this, right? At present, we have our own trial coordinators and we have systems in place, at least in Tata Hospital, but in rest of the centers, I would imagine what problem they must be facing.
So Priyanka, would you like to say something about it? Would you be more aware?
We have started, there are some centers where we've started involving the social worker in these conversations, or at least in spreading the word, because they are able to, you know, explain the trials and all better. And usually if we want to involve a social worker or something, we usually take the local institutional level approvals on that. In ICMR guidelines, one important point is there, and which every pharma company and even the doctor makes sure of, is that the patient should not be coerced into participating the trial. So that's why there are rules that you can't, you know, really advertise as to what is happening and all, but have proper conversations explaining it. And as a pharma company also, we do not put out materials which will, you know, make patients feel, you know, they should get into the trial. It's a voluntary decision. So for those aspects, there are rules in place by ICMR. But otherwise, at an institutional level, we can navigate it accordingly, you involving the social worker.
Okay, very often, you know, Dr. Gulia, I find that if I was, say, like I was with Sloan Kettering, and I realized that if somebody was going into a trial there, they would, offer them some transport money, or they would offer them facilities for looking after their children when they came for the trial, or they would give them the, you know, transport money for traveling and making arrangements for their hotel stay and things like that, you know. Also, everything was made comfortable because they wanted a person to come for a trial. I mean, it wasn't like bribing them or something, but it was like telling them that we care for you and we are looking after you. So do we have something like this in India also, or are all these facilities only for patients who are in America or Europe? Or
so these facilities are available, but as Priyanka has also alluded just now, that we should not give them extra monetary benefits also, because that will be considered as a, that we are forcing them to participate in the trial. So we do explain it to them at the time of informed consent, that if you participate in the trial, and if there is all investigation that are related to the trial or all visits will be covered, and if they develop any side effects because of participation in the trial, all that will be taken care of by the trial, right? Suppose if they have, if they develop some injury and it was reported, it was found to be related to the participation in the trial, so then some compensation will also be given to them. So all these factors are taken into consideration. But taking care of the children, I think that will be too much, and that will force them to participate in the trial. They will think that, oh, by participating in the trial, I'll be get this benefit. That should not be the main aim.
Yeah, but maybe, you know, in India, we have the family, extended family to look after the children, yeah. Whereas in America, they have to think of, you know, babysitters or something like that to leave the children. So maybe that is a thing which is a necessity there, which may not be considered a necessity in India, you know, that children can still be left behind. But, you know, you were mentioning about injuries in a trial. Now, how do you decipher that this injury is related to the trial and this is, or this complication has come up because of the trial or because of not being on the trial? You know, like, how do you know that? Because the medicines have been changed, something new is being given to the person. So from a layman's point of view, everything which is happening to him or her is due to the medicines he has taken. But you may say that it is not because of this. So how do you really come to know that?
So Priyanka in the beginning has explained what are the different phases of the trial. So whenever a trial comes to phase two or phase three, that means a new medicine is being tested. All what all side effects that medicine can do, can have, is already being studied. So we have a fair amount of knowledge that with this medicine, these are the likely side effects that can happen. And when a patient participates in the trial and suppose that patient develops some side effects, like the patient develops high blood sugar because of participation in the trial, and if that medicine can cause high blood sugar level, then this, whatever adverse event happens, that will be informed to the ethics committee. So the whole ethics committee will assess the patient condition, assess the side effects, and then the team of doctors will decide whether this injury is related to the participation on the trial or not related to the participation on the trial. So it's not a one individual decision, it's a collective decision, and based on the previous information that is available regarding related to that medicine.
So tell me one more thing about this informed consent that always intrigues me. Do the patients really take time to sign it? Do they take it home and read it and sign it? Or they say, aap jaisa bolenge, doctor sahab, hum waisa karenge.
So this is a common scenario in India that they will say, you try to explain them, then say, okay, whatever you say, you decide for me. Right? What is best for me? So in on such patient, we definitely will not take their signature immediately on the same day. We again explain it to them that these are the side effects with the new drug that are expected. Please go home, read this paper, and we give them in a language which they can understand, like Hindi, Marathi, or Bengali, whatever they can understand. Go home, you come back tomorrow and rediscuss with us. And if you are still willing to participate, then only we'll take their signature and enroll them in a trial.
So do you protect yourself by recording the statement of they're saying that Dr. Sahab, aap kuch bhi kariye, aap jaisa kahenge. Because see, tomorrow if some complication happens, then you are the one who's going to be liable, na? Because the patient has participated, and then they may turn around and say that, you know, the doctor
didn't tell me this.
And, yeah, so
I mean, since last I think Priyanka can correct me, last 3-4 years, this audio visual recording of infant informed consent has started, where we record the whole process of informed consent. First, we take the consent from that we are doing an audio visual recording for you. Are you willing for that? If they say yes, then audio visual recording is done for the whole process of informed consent.
So what happens if the trial is aborted? Priyanka, maybe in some centers you have found that it's not doing good so well, and then you decide that it has to be aborted. What is the process in that?
Usually a trial is terminated or aborted because of mainly two reasons. One is it's not showing an effect. The medicine is not working. It's not doing, the effectiveness is not there, or it's not being efficacious, as we call it. Or it could be a safety concern that there are maybe some new side effects that have come out that is not good for the patients. In those cases, the trial is stopped across. Wherever it has been conducted, we completely stop the trial, and we move the patients as per the doctor, treating doctor takes the decision and moves the patient onto the available treatment options, alternative therapies. But in case if a center is not doing something, could be wrong that maybe the data collection is not happening in a very transparent manner, or some other problem they are facing. They have, because ethics committees also have to be approved, registered, and all that. So if there are other logistical issues, then even if the trial is stopped at one center, then we try to move the patient into another center where the trial is still ongoing. Because at the end of the day, we have to take care of the patient's well-being also. So stopping a treatment abruptly in the middle is not a good solution. So therefore, then at that time, we move patients onto another center as per the patient's convenience. If they are from out of town, then we'll try and find it closest to their home. Or if they are within town, then the other hospital in the same city, we will try and move the patients to that. And make sure that the treating physician of their actual treating physician and the new investigator are in contact with each other.
So, Dr. Gulia, if to the same question to you, that if a trial is aborted, what do you tell the patient?
So, I mean, this we tell them in the beginning, also at the time of informed consent, that you are willing to participate in this study. And we don't know whether this medicine will work or not. And this is what we are trying to find out. But even during your participation in a clinical trial, if some new research comes up, and if that research suggests that medicine Y is working better than medicine X, then patient has a right that they themselves can withdraw from the trial and they can go on to the treatment Y. So whatever new treatments have come up, that also information we keep providing to the patient, and this is their right to know what is the new available treatment. And at that time, they can decide whether they continue to participate in the trial or they want to come withdraw from the trial and they want to try the another drug. Or if the treating doctor feels that it is not safe for a patient to continue in the trial, the doctor can also suggest the patient that you should withdraw from the trial, or if they are facing undue side effects. But if the trial is aborted, and if that patient continues to respond to the treatment which they are receiving, then as Priyanka mentioned, we will speak to the pharma company which was conducting the trial, that this patient medicine should continue. They should continue to get the treatment. If not at this center, if some other center, they can go and take the treatment.
Okay. So Dr. Gulia, now, I wanted to ask you, just yesterday I got an email from a patient saying he's got Ewing sarcoma, and he wants to find out if there are any trials which are happening in the country. So, would his treating doctor not tell him about the trials? Why should he get worried about it? And why should he want to know, if at all? And then what are the places that one can, the sites that one can approach to see which trials are going on?
I mean, ideally, the treating doctor should tell the patient that what all trials are ongoing in India, right? Because everybody is aware. And if they are not aware, they can easily find out from their colleagues or different centers, which trials are ongoing for a particular disease.
But is there a website that a patient can visit, and will the doctor accept that?
I don't know whether there is any website available in India for all the trials which are being happening all over India.
We can go to CTRI, the Clinical Trial Registry of India, and check with the indication there. And there at the CTRI website, per trial, all the centers that the trial is being conducted and the doctor's names are available. Okay. So one option is patient can go there and look at it and then go back and speak to their doctor about it.
Okay, but in most cases, what is your thing? You know, like suppose I write to Navya, which is the second opinion portal,
right,
and I get a thing that, you know, this is available. This trial is available for you and maybe you can contact. So will the doctors accept that opinions given by Navya for a clinical trial? Or if I go on a website, like you said, clinical trial registry, and I approach a doctor, will that be accepted by the doctor?
Don't yes,
if you don't want.
No, that's not the case. If suppose a patient is treated at some XYZ center, and if they are eligible for a clinical trial, which is happening at our center, they can definitely come to our center. And if they are fulfilling all the criteria, they will be taken up in the trial. So, but the decision whether the patient will be a candidate to participate in the trial, that will lies with us and not with the opinion given by someone else.
Dr. Gulia, I've heard this term placebo.
Yeah.
So would you like to talk about that?
So placebo is basically a non-medicinal, it could be a tablet, it could be a liquid, it could be a powder, it could be in any form. So placebo is in the control arm. Suppose we are trying to see what is the efficacy of a medicine A. So with what it will be compared? It can be either compared with another medicine B, which has shown that this medicine works in this treatment, or it can be compared with a placebo. That means, and that placebo, it resembles exactly, it has to be in the same formulary as the medicine which is being tested. Suppose if a tablet is being tested, it has, that placebo will also be like a tablet. Usually these placebo-controlled trials are done in a setting where disease is well-controlled. For disease which is advanced and in life-threatening conditions, the placebo-controlled arm is not allowed. So there are regulations which the government or the FDA also controls in what setting, what type of trial is allowed. Right? So placebo is usually taken as a control arm when there is no effective treatment available. Right? Like in certain disease, where disease is under control, should we treat them more or should we stop treatment here? In such scenario, the tablet or the medicine A can be compared with a placebo.
So one more term that comes often is randomized trials. What does that mean?
Randomized means if we are trying to compare treatment A versus treatment B. So suppose there are 500 patients that will be enrolled in the trial. So in this 500, 250 will come to treatment A and 250 will come to treatment B. But in this randomized means, if patient one has come to A, patient two will not go to B. So this is not decided pre-hand. So second patient will have equal chance to go into either of the arm, either the arm A or the arm B. So that means this, there are various ways in which this whole thing is computed, which patient will go to which arm. So neither the doctor knows the patient will go to which arm, nor the patient can know beforehand. So when we counsel the patient for a randomized trial, we tell them, so this trial is comparing this treatment versus the standard of care. You have equal chance of going into either of the arm. We cannot control that.
Okay. It is like the tossing of a coin, that you have a choice, you know, you have 50-50 chance of going into any of the two arms. At every instance.
Yeah.
So Priyanka, all the pharma companies are on fire because of the COVID vaccinations that have come in. Because normally they say that it takes a lot of time for a trial to develop, right? Normally.
Right. Normally it does.
So how come the COVID trial has come so soon? And how do the products under trial qualify for emergency use? Is it safe?
Okay. So I'll take the first part of the question first. In terms of the COVID trials, be it the vaccinations or the medicines that are coming into the market, one point is, in case of vaccinations, what usually used to take 3-4 years, it has been crunched into 1 year. It's, first of all, there were few aspects of it which helped in the expedited way of working. One is, there was a complete sharing of knowledge. usually when a vaccine is developed by one company, it is the that company's information, you know, patented thing and everything. But as soon as coronavirus was identified, the genomic sequence, once they identified it, it was shared with everyone around. So to begin with, there was a lot of knowledge sharing that laid the basis of these trials. So that made it faster. Then secondly, a lot of sequential steps have been done parallelly to save time. So we were talking about, you know, the phase one and two have been combined so that the dose can immediately be identified. So that has also reduced the timelines a bit. And the most important thing is one of the reasons we have a delay in conducting a trial is because we get patients at a certain rate. You know, patients come to the doctor and the doctor sees the patient is eligible and the patient goes into the trial. But with the pandemic, you know, being of this nature, it was very easy to get patients. So tens of thousands of patients were enrolled in these vaccine trials across the globe at a much larger scale. So that's why there also time was saved. So with all those things, the time has been saved in these vaccine trials or the drug trials that we are conducting.
So you say that it is all very safe from the patient? Because, you know, everybody, there are a lot of apprehensions.
Yeah.
One should get vaccination, whether adequate work has been done on it or not. And
right.
You know, the media blows it up every day. There's a new news on every breaking news channel. So.
Yeah. So I would say that, on a personal level, what is actually right now being looked at is the benefit-risk ratio. In a normal vaccine trial, I think the mumps vaccine was the fastest one. It took 4-5 years to come out. There are years of data because you follow the patient after the vaccination and check how they are doing. In this case, that years of data of following the patients is not happening. We are getting 6 months data. We are getting lesser amount of data. So that concern still is there. But at the same time, the benefit-risk ratio, if you look at it, whether the patient will benefit or the people will benefit from the vaccine versus getting the disease. So based on that, with the available data of the safety of the vaccine, the decision is being taken whether we should go ahead with this or not. And actually, that is also the basis of the emergency authorization use. Because in the emergency authorization use, the government or the FDA, be it the US FDA or our Indian health authorities, they are looking at, you know, a few criteria. First of all, the seriousness of the disease. Secondly, they are seeing if what they are proposing is effective or not. There has to be some data to prove it's an effective solution or a medicine. Secondly, risk benefit. Third, and then finally, are there any other alternatives? If there are no alternatives, then based on these criteria, the government is giving emergency approval. But at the same time, they have put down some conditions that, you know, like for the vaccines, first 100 patients were supposed to be dosed, 7 days you monitor them. After that, if they're safe, you'll roll it out to the public like that. And after it's also rolled out to the public, you have to continue to conduct clinical trials because that years of data that we are missing out here is now being collected on a real-time basis to check whether the thing is safe or not. That's how we're working on it because it's because of the urgency, the way of approaching it has changed.
Yeah. So one more thing, Dr. Gulia, maybe you would like to tell us, what are the precautionary measures looked into from patient perspective by the doctor and the pharma?
Regarding any trial.
Yeah.
Yeah, as the pharma, as new medicine doesn't come into market overnight, there are some first cell studies are done, which we call it as cell line studies are done. Then in studies are done in animal models. Then phase one study comes, then phase two comes, and then it is given to the larger population from phase three onwards. So before the clinical trial is being, rolled out, significant amount of time research has gone into to understand what could be the side effects of the medicine, right? So there are certain medicines which do not go beyond phase one because they have significant side effects. If they are not safe enough, that patient will be enrolled into those studies. So they are out even before phase one or at phase one. They do not reach up to phase two and phase three. So any medicine that comes to phase three, significant amount of research has already gone in and everybody looks into the data. So if a trial comes to our center, we look at what data is available before this company has reached up to phase three. And then we looked at whether these, whatever side effects are happening, what percentage of patients are having these side effects and what is the seriousness of these side effects. Then once it is done, then our hospital ethics committee also looked at the whole trial in detail. What could be the side effects? What could be the risk if patient participate in the trial? So there are multiple checkpoints which are there before the first patient is enrolled into the clinical trial.
But while undergoing the trial, there are any risk factors?
So the risk of getting side effects because of treatment is already there. And that is why there are in a trial setting, more blood investigations are done, patients are checked at a more frequent interval, and even their CT scans are done at a more frequent interval than the routine clinical practice, so as to pick up any side effect early, as well as to pick up whether disease is responding to this treatment or not. If there is any sign where the patient is experiencing more side effect, or if the disease is increasing, then the patient will be asked to withdraw from the trial and the next available best possible treatment is given to them.
Okay. Priyanka, I want to ask you this question, and not from a doctor, saying that, if you were to give caution to a patient or the family, then what would you say they should look into before taking part in the trial?
So first and foremost, what we should look at is actually the side effects of the medicine. Discuss with your doctor, is it this, if you feel this is a good treatment option for you or not as a patient, is if there are other treatment options or will this trial be a good option for me or not? Secondly, look at the safety profile. Is it, what are the kind of, side effects that are expected from this medicine? Will I be able to cope up with this something or not? Then the third thing you have to look at it is, can I actually be a part of it? Will I be able to come, because usually a clinical trial has some scheduled visits that you have to go and see the doctor, or you have to get the laboratory work done or some scan done. Will I be able to comply? Will it be possible for me to come for these visits or not? Because it's with any treatment, you should be very adhere to the treatment to get the true benefit out of it. So these are some aspects that you should always look into. First, how safe is the medicine, whether it's the right treatment for me, and can I actually adhere to that treatment or not? These are some aspects that a family and patient's family patient must look at before taking a decision of taking part.
So you just mentioned about additional laboratory tests and all that. So Dr. Gulia, what happens? Most trials cover the cost of these additional costs, because we know that most of our patients find it difficult anyway to pay for their treatment. So if there's going to be additional expenses involved, who takes care of it?
I mean, the company which is doing the trial, pharma company, will cover all the expenses of additional tests, as well as the CT scan or whatever imaging is being done as a part of the trial.
One question is that what do you mean by lay summaries? Can you explain in details?
So lay summary means what, basically in simple language, try to explain what this trial is about. What is the intent of doing this trial? What is the aim of doing this study? And what we are expecting out of this? Suppose we are treating, we are saying that we try to test medicine X in a patient who have metastatic breast cancer, right? So lay summary means that for metastatic breast cancer, these are the treatment options available. We are trying to test whether medicine X will be more useful than the medicine A, B, C, D, which are available in the market. And this is our aim, to find out this medicine can cause these many side effects. So this is all about the lay summary. What is the disease in which we are testing the medicine, what are the side effects of the medicine, and we should also write one or two lines about what are the available treatment options.
So Priyanka, can it be made pictorial, the lay summary?
To an extent, yes. I mean, we could, actually, I've not seen it done. Mostly we put it in simple terms. Like, for example, if you have, if a side effect in the clinical trial setting in the data is collected, it will be written as, say, myalgia. But otherwise, if we put it in layman terms, it becomes body ache. So we simplify the text like that. If it's fever, we'll call it, it's called pyrexia in the data, but we'll call it fever in layman terms. But definitely, I think this is something we can explore, you know, making it more visual as opposed to more textual. It's not been done very commonly, but I don't think it's something that cannot be looked at. Definitely, it's a thing. Again, a point for me to take back to everyone.
I'm sorry, but you know, I've
this is important. Patients, yeah.
So again, there's a question which has come up is that what preparation should a patient make before meeting the clinical trial team at the hospital? Should they come with somebody? Should they come alone? Should they come with a recording device so that they can record everything? What would you really suggest that they should do?
I mean, if they can come with any relative, that would be great. And usually in our country, patient comes with relative. We hardly see then any patient who comes alone to the hospital. And we will, I mean, there's no special preparation required because the patient is coming for the first time. The team there at the hospital, the doctors, the trial coordinators, they will make him understand what is the trial, what we are looking at.
Before we go, let me ask you both, each of you, give some takeaway for the patients or, you know, from the Dr. Gulia, you can give it for the pharma company also, because Priyanka is going to be representing the pharma. So I'm sure she'll take back our message there, and some message for the patients, whether they should participate or they should not participate. What should they do about their fears? So something from you, Dr. Gulia, first.
Yeah, so I would like to say that clinical trials are safe. So a lot of hard work goes in planning a clinical trial, and all efforts are taken so that the safety of the patient is protected. So, I mean, the main interest is the patient. So their safety is the utmost priority. So they should not fear from participating in the clinical trial. But before they agree to participate, they should discuss with their treating doctor in detail. They should read the informed consent in detail, and whatever queries they have, they should ask the team carefully without being fearful of asking a question, right?
Do you think trials are conducted in different ways in a government hospital and in a private setting? You know, there are trials being conducted in private hospitals, right?
Yes.
So
yes.
Is the treatment different? Is the modality different? Is the way that things are explained different?
I mean, I don't think it should be different. Why it should be different? Because the trials, suppose one trial is being run at different hospital all over India. So everybody has to follow the same protocol. There yes. cannot be any deviation from the protocol. Okay. If some blood test has to be done at week 6, it has to be done. If CT scan has to be done at week 12, it has to be done. So there cannot be any deviations. And even the pharma company also monitors how the trial is being conducted at individual site.
Yes. And in our experience, we have seen there is no difference. I mean, the doctor at a private hospital or a government hospital does give equal amount of time to the patient to explain everything to them. And they give them the same amount of time to take the decision also. So there is no difference observed, actually.
So Priyanka, your takeaway for the patients and anything that you want to tell doctors, Gulia?
No, I don't have actually, what Dr. Gulia said is absolutely right. The patients are at the heart of a clinical trial. The whole purpose of the trial is to bring a new treatment for the benefit of patients, and they are at the heart of it. So the whole idea is to ensure their well-being and their safety in the matter. So request would be that do be informed in what you're going into. There is no harm in asking the questions. There is no harm in exploring, you know, looking at all the options, because after all, it's your treatment that is in question here. So have the absolute, confidence in asking all the questions. Making an informed choice is very important, because only then will you be able to get into the treatment, adhere to it in a manner. And what are the benefits of a trial? Do look into it. In the Indian setting, we are very trusting towards our doctor, and that is how it is all over the world also. So just trust your doctor. If they have explained something, question them, understand. If you have questions, go into the internet, look into the websites of the pharma company if you're looking, if you're, you know, wondering what is happening, to just understand, make an informed decision, and speak up whenever there is a thing that you feel is not right. That helps.
You know, I feel the fact that often, I mean, it is a fact that it has to be explained that it is a new treatment that is being tried. And that sort of, you know, puts the patient in a dilemma that if it's a new treatment, should I subject myself to a treatment which has not been tried or tested? I mean, it says that it is for the benefit of community. It is for people in the, you know, at large, and almost all the medicines have been developed by clinical trials. But it, when it comes to yourself, then you are not sure whether what one should do. So how would you answer that question, Dr. Gulia?
So nowadays, most of the trials, at least in oncology settings, they are happening where if we want to test one efficacy of one drug, it is usually combined with another drug, which is known to be effective in cancer. Like, for example, I'll give an example of a breast cancer. If a patient has a metastatic disease, that means advanced disease, we know that this chemotherapy works. So usually trials are designed in a way that in both the arms, chemotherapy will be given, but in one arm, the medicine which is being tested will be given, and another arm, placebo will be given. So that the patients who are participating in the trial, they are getting the standard treatment, but over and above, they are getting one more medicine, which we are trying to test whether this works or not. So this is again to protect the safety and well-being of the patient. So this is how majority of the trials are now being designed.
And what Dr. Gulias mentioned is that actually, you know, statistically, I think 1 out of 5 drugs will see the light of even going into a clinical trial. And I think 1 out of 5,000 actually get the approval in them to go into the market. So a lot of research and work is being done in that aspect. So in terms of whether there is enough research being done, it is being done. But the risk will remain. There is, of course, a risk involved. So you have to balance it out, whether I will benefit, can I take this risk or not?
Yeah, like there's a question which says we are always wary of trying something new.
True.
So, and obviously in medicines, it's going to be even more.
Correct.
So what does, you know, like, how do we...
So that's why, because the new medicine is being tested and we are not sure whether this will work or not. This might work in one patient and it may not work in second patient. So to make sure that the medicine is working, that's why more tests are done and more frequent scans are done to ensure that the disease is being under control. And if it is not under control, then immediately patient will be withdrawn from the trial and the next best possible treatment will be given.
Okay. Just one more thing, you know, this is related to patients on active treatment and the thing is being done. But very often there are clinical trials which are being done on tissues, on, you know, on blood, on various things for which the thing has maybe taken out, maybe a permission is taken. What is the role of that? Priyanka, would you like to talk about it?
So what you are talking about is called biosample sampling, yeah, where we give a sample, like could be a tumor sample that is being done and new tests are being checked out, yeah, on it. So again, patient's consent is taken before taking the sample. And while it may not be at the time of when you are giving the consent for the sample, the patient may not know which test will be done on that sample or not. But the consent is taken that will it... your tissue is going to be taken. So the good thing is that such kind of a biosampling studies does not affect the patient directly in any which way. It is mostly like a giving your sample for some more wider research to be done. So, but at the same time, consent will be taken. So no worries there, but and your data privacy will also be maintained. So no worries there as well. But if you're not getting a drug actively, then you will not have to undergo any, you know, side effects and all.
So tell me something, if a patient has been on a trial and that trial is finally approved, does the patient get to know about it or it doesn't, I mean, it doesn't go up to that stage?
Yes, actually we do. So the results of a clinical trial no matter whether they are positive or negative, are definitely published in a public forum. So in the sense, for the scientific community, it will go out in a scientific journal in the form of a manuscript or an original article. And in websites like clinicaltrials.gov or other places, the layman, the summary of the trial report is given. And every patient who participates in a clinical trial can go back to the doctor and ask about the results. So there is a lot of transparency that's maintained after the trial results are published. And there is we as a pharma company, we are not supposed to hide any results from a trial.
So Dr. Gulia, how many patients really come back to you to find out about the results?
Very few patients ask about the result, because by the time results are out, they're usually 4 years, 5 years down the line when they participated. But we know that this patient has participated in the trial, and if that results are out, we do inform them that this was the result. Some patients are more curious, they would have read it online before coming to us. Some who are not aware, if the results are in public domain, we do tell them.
Thank you very much, and thanks for the time and information and everything. And of course, the picture that you have behind you, Dr. Gulia, it has added to the pleasures of being in the house, I'm sure. Thank you, Priyanka. And you represented the pharma companies extremely well, and we are happy about it and learning so much from both of you. I think if we have more questions later on, we'll keep on asking you about it. But it just shows the amount of time that is spent on a clinical trial, the amount of money that is spent on a clinical trial, the amount of efforts that are made from the pharma, from the doctors, and also the patients, who should not be forgotten, because they are the ones who really help in getting a clinical trial in place. So thank you once again, and we look forward to having more such information available from you. Thanks.
Thank you, Vandana ji. It was nice. I mean, the whole platform was nice, and I hope many patients would have benefited, and probably we have cleared the doubt from their mind regarding the clinical trial.
I'm sure, yes.
Yes, yes. And we are open to any questions. If more questions, more and more than happy to answer them.
Thank you. Thank you, Priyanka.
Okay, thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.